Thank you for the presentation, and my lecture will be exactly the opposite side of what Giuseppe presented right now, because he's talking about precision medicine and I'm talking about the, unfortunately, real medicine, which is pretty imprecise. So if you're looking about defining cardiotoxicity, it's defined, and if you remember my slide from the previous talk about Google Translate between oncologists and cardiologists, the same thing here. Oncologists define cardiotoxicity in rather different way than cardiologists do that. If you look at the classification of cardiotoxicity at the first row, you see CTCA version 3. It defines systolic dysfunction in 5 grades. In mild, moderate, severe, life-threatening, and grade 5 is death. It was changed lately, and at version 4, we see on a symptomatic heart failure due to drop in EF responsive to intervention. And grade 4 is refractory, poorly controlled heart failure due to EF drop. Once again, right now we're working with the CTCA V4, where oncologists are working, and they define resting EF about 50, less than 40%, between 10 and 19% drop from baseline. It's grade 2 cardiotoxicity. Resting EF between 39 and 20%, more than 20% drop from baseline. It's grade 3 severe cardiotoxicity, and resting EF less than 20. Actually, we're talking about EF decrease and appearance, symptomatic or asymptomatic heart failure. And the last review of this thing, or another classification which is accepted, is CREC classification. It's a cardiac review and evaluation committee. Actually, this committee was organized to discuss the results of the first trastuzumab trial. Any of 4 criteria confirms cardiotoxicity. First one, cardiomyopathy, reduced EF, global or most severe in the septum. The second, symptoms of heart failure without any alteration in EF. Third, signs associated with heart failure, even atrial gallop or tachycardia. Even tachycardia. 4, decrease in EF from baseline less than 5% to less than 55% with accompanying signs or symptoms of heart failure or decline in LVEF more than 10% to less than 55% without accompanying signs and symptoms of heart failure. Pretty hard to define, according to the things, cardiotoxicity. You need to be very smart and with application to define cardiotoxicity. Cardiologists are working with the 2 classification systems. It's stage A, which means we have a patient at risk. For example, patients who are receiving cardiotoxins, but without structural heart disease or symptoms. They're in risk group, it's a stage A. Stage B is structural heart disease. The patient has or hypertrophy or low ejection fraction or valve disease, but without signs or symptoms. And C is structural heart disease with prior current symptoms, and D is refractory heart failure requiring specialized interventions. And the time-respected classification is New York Heart Association symptom classification when grade Class 1 actually is no limitation of activation, and it goes through stage 1 and stage B. And grade 2 is mild limitation of activity, class 3 is marked limitation of activity, and class 4 confined to bed or chair. Actually, we have quite different classifications from only clinically based, only clinical science based, up to ejection fraction based classifications. And it's not so surprisingly that these clinical classifications are mainly in use of for trial definitions. And in real life, we have in routine clinical practice Every oncologist use actually its own modification of these classifications. I see it every day when my colleagues are asking to look carefully at echo examination when they get from one lab 55% ejection fraction, the same examination except 65, 68, or 70% ejection fraction, the same examination. And actually we are talking about inter-observer variability that's quite large. And one of my key points here is that if you want to follow the patient, do his echo examination in the same lab. It's crucially important to manage the patient carefully. And more of the oncologists are measuring resting ejection fraction and cardiac toxicity. Most of the practicing physicians are defined as more than 10% EF decline from baseline to less than 55%. More or equal to 10% EF decline from baseline to less than 50, and more than 20 or more than 15 EF decline from baseline but remaining higher than 50%, and any EF decline less than 50% is defined as cardiotoxic. So actually, if we look carefully, we know nothing about real-world incidence out of the scope of clinical trials about cardiotoxicity, because everybody uses various surveillance protocols, different EF cutoff points, different patient population, and short duration of follow-up. This is the main problem. Everything goes for a short run. Incidence of chemotherapy and heart failure, if you look here, you see that in different studies, with different protocols, with different patient populations, from lymphoma and breast cancer and testicular cancer, you see that cardiotoxicity, according to trial design, varies from 4% to 19% till 20%, and incidence of heart failure symptoms from 0 to 22%. So actually, that's what we know from the real world of registries. And incidence of overt cardiac toxicity in more than anthracycline and anthracycline trastuzumab treated patients, probably less than 5%. Significantly larger proportion experience asymptomatic reductions in EF. Women do not know exactly when to assess the EF. Who knows what happens with the EF of the patient after 24 hours, 72 hours after trastuzumab injection or any other drugs? Nobody checks it. We have the guidelines to look at EF after 3 months or 6 months. It's arbitrary indicated points. And prognostic value of an asymptomatic decline in LVEF that remains more than 50% for cardiovascular or cause mortality is not known. So actually we do not know what it means when the patient EF is dropping from 65 to 60%. Is it clinically plausible to do anything about this? Do we need to do another examinations or another biomarkers? Cancer treatment affects cardiovascular system at different levels. It can cause arrhythmia, atherinflammation, it can cause myocardial damage, lungs problems, skeletal muscle problems, and even renal vascular damage. And every kind of anti-cancer therapy, from doxorubicin through molecular therapies, radiation, cause this what we call multiple heat injury. And the only thing the practicing physician can do to modify all known risk factors, somehow to diminish these multiple heat injuries. To treat obesity, hypertension, we have nothing to do with aging. So when is cardiovascular safety relevant in antineoplastic drugs? When it is expected cure or long-term remission? When there are pre-existing cardiovascular risk factor or disease, impaired cardiac reserve, irreversibility of cardiotoxicity, impaired survival quality or quality of life. In this case, it's relevant cardiovascular safety to antineoplastic drugs. And in this paper, nice paper from the group of Douglas, it was published in Circulation 2012, they show nice cartoon of integrated concept of cardiotoxicity. You can do biomarkers, you can do tissue Doppler and targeted nuclear cardiology imagings. You can do traditional imaging by echocardiography and nuclear cardiology. But everything goes through these red boxes. Baseline cardiovascular health and risk factors, it's a baseline of what we're working with. When this patient gets cancer diagnosis, it's very important what kind of organ gets cancer. If it's the strong man without comorbidities or advanced age with multiple comorbidities. What kind of cytotoxic therapy you are going to give to the patient? And what's the possibility or probability of cardiac toxicity as reduction in EF? And in this case, every patient that gets cytotoxic therapy actually get the in the group of stage B according to ACCHA classification. And from this time, actually, somebody goes to cardiovascular disease and gets premature death or goes to heart failure. When we can intervene in this green box, you have to do primordial prevention during the initiation of cancer therapy, before the initiation of cancer therapy. It's one approach. It's not approved. It's not, nobody knows if you can give to all patients who are getting cardiotoxic therapy, ACE inhibitors and beta blockers, and prevent cardiotoxicity. No serious work in this field was done yet. Primary prevention by treating risk factors. Secondary prevention after we have the class stage B heart failure, and treatment by accepted secondary prevention means. Actually, monitoring strategies, options what we have is maybe genotyping the patient by genomic sequencing. We will be able to identify the patient that will develop cardiotoxicity, and in this case, give some kind of precise medicine. Blood biomarkers, troponin, BNP, any metabolomics maybe will be helpful in the future. Imaging biomarkers, echo, systolic and diastolic dysfunction, strain imaging, nuclear systolic function, MRI, cardiac CT may be helpful. And in my opinion, functional exercise testing is very important thing in the clinical evaluation of the patients to predict the chance of developing cardiotoxicity. Options for detection of cardiotoxicity are various, and you see here echocardiography, radionuclear imaging, CMR, blood biomarkers, and every one of these things can give some degree of confidence, but actually potential is quite low. And even now we have only for troponin somehow robust data about the usefulness of these things. Management of cancer therapy related cardiotoxicity. Right now, again, we have no good trials. We have in this column, you see the number of the patients enrolled in these trials. I think altogether it's about less than 300 patients, all these trials. So it's a very small, without control groups, and it's very low quality trials. And actually, they only are hypothesis generating. So, in conclusion, there is no universally accepted definition of cardiotoxicity. Longer and larger longitudinal studies are needed urgently to define clinical importance of positive blood and imaging biomarkers and relationship with clinical events, determine the optimal strategy for detection of subclinical myocardial dysfunction, delineate importance of subtle symptomatic EF declines, compare different medications, doses, and pharmacologic combinations for use in preventive strategies, and evaluate cardiovascular interventions in patients receiving conventional and or novel adjuvant therapies. And developing cardio-oncology partnership is the main thing. Thank you.